What is up, guys? I'm KBHD here, and this is the Essential Phone. So it's finally in the studio. You guys were asking when I would make a video on it. It was delayed. The hype train was months and months of teasing long, but it's finally here, and it's actually starting to ship. So a new phone from a new company hoping to make big moves. Now, we've heard this story before of a new smartphone company coming up and trying to make waves, but in this world of Samsungs and Apples, if you actually do want to break the mold, you have to pick something to do a little bit different. So with this one, it's kind of all in the name. It's supposed to be the Essential Phone. So there's no bells and whistles. You won't find any frills or gimmicks or extras with this one. It's just pure Android and specs and design. So you see that right out the box. There are no pre-installed apps, just Google's. No bloatware, no crazy extra stuff, no face unlock, no waving gestures or anything you might find in an LG or Samsung skin. There's one spec, one unlocked 128 gig version, and it's priced right up there with the flagships. And design-wise, it looks and feels very premium, as it should for that price. Plus, it has some really unique choices. It has a ceramic back, first of all, which is an extremely durable, quality material. You might have seen jewelry and watches and other surfaces made of ceramic. It's extremely difficult to scratch, so that's a good start. And then it squares off to the sides, which are titanium instead of aluminum, like most other phones. So right off the bat, you have an extremely durable outer shell materials, ceramic and titanium, which should ideally make it stand up to drops way better than average. Now, this is still a super shiny, super fingerprinty, and potentially a little bit slippery phone. I mean, the titanium sides do a pretty good job of giving you something to grip because they're square. I think rounded sides would be way worse, but this still feels like something I'm gonna end up skinning for better grip. And the buttons on the side, they're well placed, and the volume buttons are nice and clicky, but the power button's a little bit small. I would've liked a bigger, clicky, ridged power button, but that's just me. So around the back, you have no camera bump at all, which is awesome, and you get dual 13 megapixel cameras, the flash and the mics, and then two pins on the side for some magnetic attachable accessories, including a 360 degree camera, which I thought worked pretty well in the limited time I got to play with it. And then the fingerprint reader is up in the middle near the top, so it's decently reachable. So the dual cameras are interesting. We've seen a bunch of different versions of this in phones. Sometimes it's a portrait mode, sometimes it's a super wide angle. This second 13 megapixel camera is a monochrome sensor, which will in theory allow you to capture way more detail and sharpness than a regular color sensor, and then combine the two to make a ultimate capture. Now, I say it's supposed to, or it's allegedly gonna do this, because I haven't tested it yet, and that's one of the things I definitely will be testing to make sure it works. But on paper, at least the way they describe it, it makes sense. When you put an optical filter over a sensor to allow it to distribute and see all the colors, you do get beautiful colors in the whole entire spectrum, but you are putting something over the sensor. So when you take a sensor and don't put that filter over it, it doesn't see the colors, but then you get way better sharpness and clarity and contrast and detail. So one of those has the filter, one of those doesn't have the filter, and then hopefully, ideally, the software that can be improved over time will allow it to combine those two captures and make the best possible photo. They're definitely not the first to do this. This showed up in a Huawei phone that had a pair of Leica cameras not too long ago, but bottom line is this is something that needs to be tested. And another one of those things is battery life. I've only had this phone for a little bit, so I'll have to test the battery as well for the full review. And make sure you leave any comments right below if you have anything else you definitely want to see tested and covered for the full review. So around the front of the Essential Phone is what I think makes it its best design statement. It has the edgeless display on the sides, a really thin top bezel, and that's what helps pack a 5.7 inch display into a body smaller than these two phones, which both have smaller 5.5 inch displays. So Essential Phone is a smaller phone with a bigger screen. Now it's 2017, we've seen thin bezels before. Usually the phones that do this cram the front-facing camera and the speakers and the sensors above or below the display in the tiny bezels, but obviously you can see Essential here did it differently. They push the screen right up to the top, but then literally have a cutout for the front-facing camera and some sensors. This is very different. They have the earpiece for the phone calls and the LED notification light crammed really small up there above the display, which I'm sure was not easy. But then they just wouldn't settle for putting the selfie camera down below the display. They had to keep it up top. So that has some interesting effects on the UI. Some apps go full screen around the cutout, but some stop and end before it. Basically, Essential has worked with Google and some top app makers in the Play Store to get their apps working full screen. So, you know, Google Maps and the Google Play Store and things like that, and going through pictures, all those native apps, when you open them, it will stretch the UI canvas over the cutout and give you this full screen immersive look, which is really cool. But the other apps that aren't optimized yet, which is most apps, won't stretch, and they'll end actually before the camera cutout and have this black bar above them. Now, I don't hate this. I think it would be a little smoother if this was an OLED display, but it's not, so it's an IPS panel. It's not pitch black up there. But still, I don't mind it, and of course, over time, more apps will begin to support this full look and do better in full screen. Oh, by the way, screenshots don't have a hole in them. They just kind of fill it over with a solid color. I know somebody out there was wondering that. But look, bottom line, I'm glad to finally have hands on this thing and to start using it and testing it for the full review to see if it's actually worth your $700. Obviously, with a name like Essential, you're kind of opening yourself up to some obvious criticism, like when people suggest a headphone jack is pretty essential. The Essential phone doesn't have one. A lot of people can't live without waterproofing. This phone's not waterproof. A lot of people really want expandable storage. Doesn't have that. No wireless charging. So it's not perfect for everyone, obviously. But right out the box, I do actually really like the Essential sort of minimal approach. When I talked to Essential at the event, which was yesterday, it was a couple of hours after Android 8.0 Oreo was officially announced and went live and started pushing out to Pixels and Nexuses. And they mentioned that because this phone is so close to stock Android, they can begin to work as quickly as possible, and hopefully soon we'll have an Android 8.0 update for Essential phone as quickly as possible. So that's one advantage to the Essential approach. So I look forward to that, and of course I'm excited to be testing this thing now over the next couple days and weeks for the full review. This is just the first impressions. So again, if you haven't already, let me know what you want to know below. If you haven't subscribed already, be sure to do that for the full review to be the first to see it when it drops. Until then, I'll be testing. Thanks for watching. Talk to you guys in the next one. Peace.